to our mission in Kenya. We have seen 8 homes be able to be built there through Anchor Church. We've been able to take 2 mission trips in the short lifespan of Anchor Church. And we adopted 120 orphans one day a week where we feed a meal for them. If you guys remember, they were only getting 3 meals a week, not a day. A week, guaranteed. These orphans that would go to a school that a ministry was putting on in a very small but heavily populated Muslim village of Kenya. And so Anchor Church, we, because of your tithes and offerings, have been able to support them. But God's doing something even bigger than just feeding them another meal a day. Now they get 5 guaranteed meals a week from every single day. And across the street, the organization has been able to purchase land. Land that they will be able to farm and use to make money for that community. Land that they will be able to build a building on that can be an actual school and a medical facility as well as a church on the weekends. The school that they currently have is about 1/4 the size of this room, and it is mud huts just wall to wall. They lack very little in line of supplies. There's almost none. And the vision for this community is to see how Christians can help support this village, these young children, and allow the gospel to penetrate their lives and the community that they live in, to see transformation take place, to help lift them up out of their poverty and move them to a place of incredible education, abilities that they would not have before. And so Anchor Church, we're playing a part of that. We're not playing the whole part, but we're playing a small part of what God's doing. And over this next year, I think he's going to do something very incredible. I think within our body, we have got an amazing group of people. You guys might say, hi, nice to meet you. Jared told me to greet you. You know, I read an article from Tom Rainer and said, don't do the greeting thing because guests don't really like that. Introverts hate it. Well, I really want to encourage you to just get to know some folks around you because we've got an incredible group of people here. I mean, we have CEOs and doctors and nurses. We've got moms. And I mean, it's incredible. He's assembled an incredible group. And I think within this group, there are people who have insights towards construction, maybe general contractors out here in our church that could help and cast some vision and insight to the building of this building. Maybe in the medical field that can help cast some vision and insight to a team and an organization that can build and be able to equip a very, very small but very desperate village for some medical supplies. Really sad story. Joseph Okello. He is the leader of this group. He's got several children. He was on a mission trip in Tanzania. And back home, his wife and his child were at that village. The child got sick. He had the car. It's like the only car in the village because he took it to go on a mission trip to serve God. The wife took the child to the doctor. The doctor said, "You don't have enough money. Go back and get more." She had half of what she owed. She asked to see if he could be treated with half, and she'd go back to return, and the doctor said, "No, we can't do that." She went back to get the money, and on the way back, that child died. Now imagine if in that remote village they had some access to some very basic things like medical supplies to help treat illnesses like malaria that are very preventable when given the right treatment. I think there's people in this church that have got the right skill set to help us shape that and lead that. I think for planting a church, maybe someone's a missionary heart, where their heart is just for the nations, and they want to help shape that and how they could see the gospel be planted and grow and affect and reach Muslims and secular folks alike that are outside the village. And so they're within this body. And if you're interested in that, next Sunday at 3:00, it's a building on Wyoming and Spain. It's by the Burger King, okay? It's just north of the Burger King. It's called the Baptist Building. And it's a building where we're going to meet. And at 3:00, we're going to have a meeting. And you guys get to meet with Bruce. Bruce, why don't you just stand up, okay? So everybody can see that gorgeous hair of yours, the shiny gray. The Bible says that's wisdom right there. And that's my father-in-law, so I get to do that. But you guys can talk with Bruce. He's the point on this. He's in charge. He's leading this effort. And so if you're interested in missions, going to Kenya possibly, or maybe you're like, you know what? I don't want to get Ebola. Okay? You crazies, you can go risk it, even though it's on the other side of the continent there. But I can help. I can help here with strategy, planning, prayer. I'm just thinking about all the clothes we collect. Every year, we take luggage upon luggage upon luggage of clothes for children and families in Kenya. And they just sit in my garage. And you know what I do? I take your trash bag full of clothes and I dump it in a luggage. And but maybe there's somebody in the church that is really organized and like has a Pinterest account set up already about where to put clothing and what bags, and you could mark them for little infants and two threes, and you know, you could do a much better job than me just stored in my garage. Maybe you want to take up that lead and say, I'm not going to go, but here's how I can help. There's a lot of opportunities to give, to pray, to serve. If you want to be involved with that, talk with Bruce afterwards. We're going to send out a blast for an email for Anchor Church, and you can find out more information about that. And if you're like, well, they don't have my email. How are they going to send me info? That's a great question. I'm glad you asked. You're making this very easy for me. Thank you for asking. You fill out a little info card on your way out, and you drop it off in our offering box or leave it on our welcome table, and we will make sure to put you on our email list and give you information about it. We send emails about once a month or so. We're not going to hound you, okay? Let's pray. God, shifting gears, Lord, we want to hear from you in your word. We ask that you administer to us, that you change lives. And right now, I know how it is. You can come into church, you can sit down, and you can start thinking about 17 different things going on in your life. And you can check in or check out. You can say, is this interesting or not? But Lord, I pray that you'd captivate hearts and minds right now. And Lord, I pray that we would give you our full attention. We would lean in. We would just amp up right now to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we've been going through this series called The Fruit of the Spirit, the 9 attributes of the fruit of the Spirit. And these are things that God can do in your life, that he can produce in and through you. This is a product of his fruit. It's nothing that you can do on your own. You cannot obtain this by working at it or getting better at it or trying harder. You have to have God's Spirit, first of all, living in you in order to display his fruit. You can't have the fruit of the Spirit if you don't have the Spirit of God. And this is a great gift that God gives his people. This is a great gift that he gives his people. Those who are called by him, who have given their life over him, asked for forgiveness of sin, who have come to him and said, God, will you be my Savior? Will you be my Lord? So without that component, you can't display the very fruit of the Spirit. But God has been at work throughout all of humanity, trying to bridge the gap between man and himself. Because of sin in this world, in our own lives, that has caused a major barrier between us and God. Some people say, I just don't think God hears me. I feel like my prayers bounce off of the ceiling. Well, it might be that you've never given your life over to Jesus Christ. You've never asked God to forgive you of your sins. And so you feel like God's turned a deaf ear to you, and he's just waiting for you to give your life to him. And all throughout history, he's been trying to bridge that relationship, the brokenness of the relationship that sin has caused. Early on, he develops this term, covenant. He talks about making a covenant with people. That's a term we don't really use, even today. You know, as a pastor, I get to use it in premarital counseling quite a bit because marriage is a covenant between you and your spouse and God. But it's a word that has been lost in our English society today. We don't use the word covenant quite a bit. We use words like contract. And we use more informal words like you know, let's just be friends. And in our society, we've gotten away from this idea of covenant because it's very formal. It sounds very formal. And God's saying, I'm going to display greatly my love and the law through covenant. They go hand in hand. God's display of love for humanity and his law that he has placed upon humanity. And we look at the law and we think, gosh, I'm not perfect. I can't be perfect. I'm never going to be perfect. I just wish I could be better, but I can't. And God's love comes alongside and says, I know you can't be perfect. That's why I'm setting up a covenant with you. Tim Keller writes about this idea, about God's law and his love in covenant. And I love the way he describes it. He says, why is there such a great need for God to have this formal relationship with us, this idea of covenant? It is because of his important formal relationship that we are even able to have a relationship with God. Let me give you some background here to a covenant. When you enter into a covenant with God, and in ancient biblical times, if a covenant were to be broken, it would cost someone their life. For the covenant to be broken, blood would need to have been shed. Those were the stakes, and they were very high. And God shows us his love even when we break his law. See, we want this relationship with God to be very formal. He does call himself a friend of sinners, that we are his friend. He does call him a father to his children. Those are aspects of the relationship that we have with God. But he has established his covenant as an aspect of relationship with his people. And we desperately need that. Because guess what we do on a daily basis? We break that covenant with our words, our thoughts, our actions, our sin. We don't live up to the bargain. We can't fulfill the law. And it's because of God's great love that he says, blood will be shed to keep this covenant intact. And it will be the blood of my son, Jesus Christ. And so Jesus did a great work on the cross when he died for the sins of humanity. And he rose again 3 days later, conquering sin and death, and ascended to heaven to give us life in his very spirit. See, it's with that covenant that God has established, we've broken the law, we are sinners, and God says, I love you so much that I'm going to send my son to shed blood so that we can have restoration of the relationship. And that is a good thing. And in Scripture, we look at many different relationships that people have with God. And we kind of have our judgmental eyes on others. When somebody sins or messes up or does something wrong to us, our judgmental eyes come out. Or we think, they really shouldn't talk like that or act like that. Or I wouldn't do it that way. And there are four very profound stories of women who interacted with God that the world around them was looking upon them with very judgmental eyes. If you have your Bibles, you can open up to Joshua chapter 2. We are going to be all over the place today, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to tour the Bible, okay? And I want you to be able to see the power of this relationship that God extends and the manner in which he goes about extending this relationship. And in Joshua chapter 2, Israel has been out of Egypt now, and they are going to the promised land. God had promised his people, Israel, who he had made a covenant with, that he would give them Canaan, the land of milk and honey, the promised land, that they are not there quite yet, but they're going towards it. Moses has now died, and his predecessor is in place, and they are still marching forward to get to the land, and they've got all these obstacles in their way. They've got a giant obstacle in their way. The city of Jericho, the greatest fortified city of the day. Walls that reached like towers into the sky that were said to be the most fortified and protected from war. Jericho. And so the leader sends out spies into the city. And I want you to get in the mind frame of a spy going into a foreign land, trying to blend in, collect information and data, and just make it out alive so that you can report back what's going on. In chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "And Joshua, the son of Nun, sent two men secretly from Shittim and spies, saying, 'Go view the land, especially Jericho.' And they went and came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there." This relationship that God has with Rahab is very, very interesting. These spies are looking to blend in. They're looking to gather intel. And where do they land? They land in the home of a prostitute. These godly men, these spies, end up in the home of this prostitute. Verse 2 says, "And it was told to the king of Jericho, 'Behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land.'" The word is out. Spies are in the city. Everyone is on full alert. The guards will be soon searching for these spies. Outsiders will be recognized and exposed. Verse 3 says, "Then the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, 'Bring out the men who have come to you, who entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land.' But the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, 'True, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from.' And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. 'I do not know where these men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them.'" Verse 6, "But she had brought them up onto the roof and hid them with stalks of flax. And she set and she laid in order on the roof. So the men pursued after them on the way to the Jordan as far as the fords. And the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone." Now, Rahab, the prostitute, had lied. She had misled the guards to protect these spies. She was doing her very best to keep them safe. Why would a woman risk her life for two strangers? Why would one who is already considered a little bit of an outsider and an outcast in her community do something to be even worse? Wouldn't she want to build her stature amongst the people? Verse 8 says, "Before the men lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men," here's the why, "'I know that the Lord has given you the land, and the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, Sihon and Gog, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted. There was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, He is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with me in my father's house. And give me a sure sign that you will save me alive and my father and mother, my brothers and sisters and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death.' And the men said to her, 'Our life is for yours, even to death. If you do not tell this business of ours, then when the Lord gives us the land, we will deal kindly and faithfully with you.'" So here's the sign that's going to take place. Verse 15 says, "Then she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was built into the city wall, so that she lived in the wall. And she said to them, 'Go into the hills, or the pursuers will encounter you, and hide there 3 days until the pursuers have returned. Then afterward, you may go your way.' The men said to her, 'We will be guiltless with respect to this oath of yours that you have made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, you shall tie a scarlet cord in this window through which you will let us down. And you shall gather into your house and your father and mother and brothers and all of your father's household. Then if anyone goes out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head. And we shall be guiltless. But if a hand is laid on anyone who is with you in the house, his blood shall be on our head. But if you tell this business of ours, then we'll be guiltless with respect to your oath that you have made us swear.' And she said, 'According to your word, so be it.' Then she sent them away and departed, and she tied the scarlet cord in the window. They departed and went into the hills," in verse 22, "and remained there 3 days until the pursuers returned. And the pursuers searched all along the way and found nothing. Then the two men returned. They came down from the hills and passed over and came to Joshua, the son of Nun, and they told him all that had happened to them. And they said to Joshua, 'Truly, the Lord has given all the land in our hands, and also all the inhabitants of the land melt away because of us.'" So spies, they get to go back. They're saved by the prostitute. And they report that this shall be ours as well. We will have victory. The Lord has given us victory. And you got to imagine the angst. You know, Rahab has been lied to by men. She has been discarded by men. She has been treated as worthless by men. And imagine those 3 days. Will they come through? Are they going to be true to their word? Or are they just going to discard me like everyone else has? They serve this mighty God who is victorious. How is that God going to deal with me, a sinner? Joshua chapter 6, verse 17, you jump ahead a couple of chapters, and it says, "And the city and all that is within it shall be devoted to the Lord for destruction." Uh-oh. "But only Rahab the prostitute and all who were with her in her house shall live, because she hid the messengers whom we sent." Verse 22 says, "But the two men who had spied out the land," Joshua said, "go into the prostitute's house and bring her out from there, the woman and all who belonged to her, as you swore." And so the men who had been spies went and it brought out Rahab and her father and mother and brothers and all who belonged to her. And they brought out all her relatives and put them outside the camp of Israel. And they burned the city with fire and everything in it, only silver and gold and the vessels of bronze and iron they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. But Rahab the prostitute and her father's household and all who belonged to her, Joshua saved alive. And she has lived in Israel to this day. And to this day is when it was written, because she hid the messenger of whom Joshua had sent the spy out of Jericho. You know, the spies send word up to the leader. And the leader, we don't have time for that. We've got to put this city to destruction. But he didn't think that way. And he didn't act that way. God was showing his gentleness to Rahab. One who, by the eyes of those around her, might deserve to go into the destruction as well. But God said, "No, I will rescue her and save her." This idea of being the harlot is found in one of the minor prophets, Hosea and Gomer. And the story plays out where God calls Hosea to go after and marry a prostitute. And she keeps going out and playing the harlot, as the scripture says. And God says, go after her. Bring her back. Redeem her. Hosea chapter 3 says, "And the Lord said to me, go again, love a woman who is loved by another man and is in an adulteress. And even as the Lord loves the children of Israel, though they turn to other gods and love cakes of raisins, so I have brought her for 15 shekels of silver and a homer and a lezzish of barley. And I said to her, you must dwell as mine for many days. You shall not play the whore or belong to another man. So I will also be to you, for the children of Israel shall dwell many days without king or prince, without sacrifice or pillar, without ephod or household gods. Afterwards, the children of Israel shall return and seek the Lord their God and David the king, and they shall come in fear to the Lord and to his goodness in the later days." God's saying, you, Hosea, go. You are going to be a picture of my love for Israel. You're going to be a picture of my love and my gentleness that I can show towards my people who continue to break my covenant, that I'm going to go rescue you and buy you back and redeem you. Jesus got to interact with women just like this. In John chapter 4, verse 13, says, "Jesus said to this Samaritan woman who had come to gather water at the well in the middle of the day to avoid the shame and the ridicule of going when it was cool in the morning from the other ladies who were gathering water because of her situation. And he says these words to her, 'Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. And the water that I will give him will become to him a spring of water welling up in eternal life.' And the woman said to him, 'Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or come here to draw water. And she didn't know what she was getting into here. She didn't understand fully that Jesus was offering this woman who had been caught up in her sin, who Jesus had identified that she had been with five other husbands and the boyfriend she was currently living with. And Jesus said, I want to offer you eternal life. That's the thing about God. He goes deep fast. Sometimes we prance around and we get into relationships and friendships with those who are far from God. And we're really working hard to earn the right to be able to share Christ. And that's good. But at some point, we got to get to that place where we talk about real deep issues and not just surfacey things. Jesus goes deep fast and identifies the sin that she is in. And he offers and extends to her eternal life. In John chapter 8, the same book, there's another woman who the scribes and the Pharisees had caught in an adulterous affair. Notice how they treat women in that day. They didn't bring the man who was caught in the same affair. They brought the woman. And they were asking Jesus, what do we do with this woman who's caught in sin? She should be stoned. And here's how Jesus responds. Verse 3 of chapter 8 says, then the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law of Moses, it commands us to stone such a woman. So what do you say? This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, let him who is without sin among you to be the first to throw the stone at her. And once more he bent down and wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. And Jesus stood up to her. Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? She said, no, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Go. And from now on, sin no more. Jesus went deep fast as well. He combined the covenant of his law and his love side by side, simultaneously. And all throughout Scripture, we see God doing this in people's lives. He deals with us gently. Our sin deserves punishment. When we sin, we are literally taking offense against God. We are taking up arms, the Bible says, and we're an enemy of God because of sin and the separation of the relationship that sin has caused. And something has to be done about that. And instead of God being an incredibly vengeful God, wiping us off of the planet, saying there's no hope for a relationship, he says, no, I'm going to choose to deal gently. When Galatians chapter 5, verse 23 begins the new kind of set of fruit of the Spirit, we see that he says the fruit of the Spirit is gentleness. And you might picture in your mind like dealing with eggs and putting them in the hand of a five-year-old. You might think, be gentle. What do? You hover underneath them? But that's not actually the word here. It's not this idea of like, there, gentleness. Don't drop that. Be gentle. Don't kick your infant sister. Be gentle. The Greek word gives us this picture of God's servant submission in the midst of an accusation or attack. And it's his submission to his plan of salvation that enables him to deal gently with us where he doesn't just unleash on us. sin. You've broken the relationship. But I'm going to deal gently with you. I'm going to be submissive in this. Like, imagine that. An almighty God being submissive in the sense of he is showing us gentleness. He doesn't have to deal with us this way. But because of his character and his goodness, he acts gently. He doesn't give us what we deserve. He shows us his mercy. And he gives us what we don't deserve. He gives us his grace. And there's no more beautiful picture that I see in Scripture than how God dealt with these women that were caught in adultery, and prostitution, and very deep sexual sin. And God's saying to each of us, I extend to you my gentleness, and I want you to treat others with that same kind of gentleness. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, you could picture and imagine our submission to God's will. In James chapter 1, verse 21, you can picture and imagine our submission to being teachable. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2, you can think about our submission and our gentleness and how we treat others. So that's a question that I have for you this morning. Is, do you show the gentleness of God in those areas of your life? Are you being submissive to God's will? Because you don't have to be. In fact, many times I'm not. And God needs to gently correct me and align me back into his will. Do you show a gentleness and receptivity towards God's word and his teaching in your life that you're willing to grow spiritually and challenge yourself? Are you being gentle to those around you, not giving what they deserve, but dealing gently when others lash out at you? When you have the fruit of the Spirit, you have that ability. That's what Jesus did for us on the cross. He dealt gently with us through that act to show us his great love. And we get to be tools to the world. We get to be those who show the world God's love and how we act towards those around us. Some of you are here today and you're thinking, wow, that's really me. I've made some colossal mistakes in my life. And it might not be the sexual sin that was described here, but you know what? I've been stuck in an addiction to drugs. And at every turn and every time I grab that drug, it's my way of just saying no to God. Maybe it's addiction to alcohol, or it's some other sin that you are wrapped up in and stuck in. And you're just wondering, how's God going to deal with me? Is he going to send a lightning bolt down? I'm a little worried about going into church. I'm glad it's at the school. And there's no steeple and stained glass. His lightning's going to come down there. There's a little caveat. He wants to show you his love. Today can be and should be the day that you surrender to his will, that you show that you can be teachable, and that you say yes to God, and you say, God, just like those women, I need to fess up, and I need to own my sin. I need to recognize that you're God, and that you're Lord, and you're going to be victorious with or without me. I just want you to include me. And you need to say to God, okay, God, you want to deal gently with me, and you want to set me free from this. You don't want me stuck in my sin anymore. You say, go and sin no more. So let's make today that day where you say yes to God and you give your life over to him and you trust him. Maybe you've never done that before in your entire life. You've never asked God to forgive you of your sins. We're going to give you that opportunity this morning to where you can experience God's gentleness come over you and give you a gift that you really don't deserve, but he wants to give it to you anyway. Maybe others of you are followers of Jesus. And you know, the first part of the fruit of the Spirit, it's living by the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. The second part is walking in the Spirit. Faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And maybe right now you're just not walking in the Spirit. You're saved. You're going to heaven. You know that for sure. But your sin has got you so wrapped up and stuck that you feel ashamed and you feel guilty. And you just, you know, maybe you'll come to church, but that's about as far as it goes for you with God right now, because you just don't want to face facts. You're not walking with God. Well, let today be the day where you just repent from that, you turn from that, and you look at God's great love and his law coming together, and it should set you free from all that guilt and all that shame and put you on a new path. Let's make that happen today. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this idea of covenant friendship and relationship. And we thank you that it is formal and that you signed the dotted line and you lived up to your side of things. And we thank you, God, that you offer us salvation. And we feel a whole lot like these women in Scripture, where we're not very deserving of it, but you're reaching out to us and you're just asking us to respond to you with a yes, with an I'm sorry for my sin, and a change me from within. And if that's you, I just want you to pray with me. Help me know that that's you by just raising your hand and saying, you know what, I need forgiveness of sin today. And I need Jesus to come into my life and change me. Would you raise your hand high so we can pray for you? You say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Transform me. I believe you are who you say you are. And I trust my life to you. Thank you for the gift of your Spirit. And Lord, for others of us here today, Lord, we don't always respond gently to others when they lash out at us. And much of that is coming from the fact that we simply have sin in our life that we're really not dealing with. We're not walking in the Spirit. We're not walking with you. We're allowing the sin to cloud you out of our daily lives. And we're still saved, and you're never going to forsake us. You're always going to be with us. But we're just kind of ignoring you right now. And so as a result, we're not very gentle with those around us, with our kids. We're not gentle with our spouse. We're not gentle at work when people do things that get under our skin. And so, God, we just want to confess that to you as sin. And we want to ask for forgiveness. And we want to ask you to set us free so that we can show the world your gentleness and that they would be drawn to your love and that they could have a relationship with you too. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I've asked the band to come and lead us in that last song. The song, Not For a Moment. And I want you to think about the words as they play and think about how God has done that for you. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. And it's because of his gentleness.
Thank you.
are only good. Thank you that you offer us your love and your grace. You show that through your gentleness. Help us to be a people that as we go into the world, that we don't demand the justice that we want to seek, that we don't lash out at others. The Lord, that we treat others the way you treated us in our sin, that we deal with them gently. So that your name may be glorified and that many will come to know you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys for coming to Anchor Church today. I want to encourage you to invite a friend with you next week. It feels full, but we'll add more chairs next week. So don't think that you get off the hook because it's full. You can't invite a friend, okay? So have a great week. We'll see you guys next week. Thanks for coming.